Hey, welcome to Night School, everybody. I'm Christina.
And I'm Darian.
Night School, we're a program of the California Academy of Sciences Nightlife, which is a weekly in-person program for adults that mixes science, art, culture, and music every Thursday night. And we're kind of the online version of that, established March 2020. So tonight on the program, we're talking about the ephemeral. I feel like I always have to do these like finger motions. Ephemeral, specifically ephemeral ecosystems that come and go with the seasons or with, say, the availability of a large marine mammal carcass. You could call them pop-up ecosystems, or again, with the large marine mammal carcass, pop-down ecosystems or sink-down ecosystems. So,
thank you, Christina.
Yeah, Darian, do you want to tell us who's on the program tonight?
Here's some of the talks you're going to be hearing tonight. The director of Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve, Joy Baccei, studies California's vernal pools. They're bodies of water which look really different depending on the season and serve as hotspots for biodiversity with a high degree of endemism, including the extremely rare Conservancy Fairy Shrimp. Shrimp in Merced, who knew? You're about to. Millions of migrating birds use the few remaining wetlands in California's Central Valley to rest and refuel. However, many of these birds are not finding what they need to do that. Kristin Sesser of Point Blue Conservation Science and Rodd Kelsey of the Nature Conservancy will share some of the innovative work the Migratory Bird Conservation Partnership is doing to dynamically deliver critical habitat by creating it when and where these birds need it most in the valley. And then lastly, our pop-down ecosystem. In 2011, an adult fin whale washed along the shore of San Diego, which, with the permission of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and what I'm sure was like lots and lots of help, scientists such as Greg Rouse, professor at Scripps Institution of Oceanography, towed her out to sea and let her fall all the way to the bottom, creating an environment known as a whale fall. He'll share with us what he's learned over the past decade of using remote operated vehicles to document the diverse ecosystem that's developed there.
And as always, tonight's program is live. So say hi. I've seen a lot of people from the Pacific Northwest. There's a big storm system there. So thanks for tuning in and hope you don't lose power. So yeah, if it's your first time joining us, let us know. We love to know if you've just stumbled here for the first time. And we'll have a Q&A after each presenter. So drop your questions in the chat and we'll get to as many as we can. So without further ado, here is Joy Baccei.
Hi there, good evening. I'm Joy Baccei and I'm the director of the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve, or MVPGR for short. And for today's Night School presentation on ephemeral ecosystems, I'd like to share a little bit about California's vernal pools, which occur in grasslands, as well as a bit about vernal pool ecology, biodiversity, and endemism, and also what we do on the Vernal Pool Reserve to support vernal pool stewardship, research, education, and public service as part of the larger UC Natural Reserve system in the great state of California. I just need to advance my slide here. Bear with me. Thank you. So first, you might be wondering, what exactly is a vernal pool? Vernal pools are essentially ephemeral wetlands, meaning that they're fleeting on the landscape. And the term vernal pool essentially refers to a seasonally wet area or wetland occurs in Mediterranean climates, those with short wet winters and hot dry summers, and forms a geographic depressional area that fills with rainwater in winter due to an underlying impermeable layer that doesn't allow rainwater to soak in, thus creating a perched water table as shown in this diagram here. And in the San Joaquin Valley, where the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve is located, the vernal pool pools are underlain by a clay hardpan that's developed through sedimentation over millions of years, that's impermeable to water percolation and thus creates these seasonal rainwater pools. And within the state of California, there are over 17 vernal pool regions, as shown by this map, which was created by the California Department of Wildlife, which was then the California Department of Fish and Game in 1998 with the help of vernal pool botanists and experts. And at the time, it was the finest statewide map for vernal pools. And you can see there's this large brown region, that's the San Joaquin Valley region. And then the red triangle there represents the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve. So within the San Joaquin Valley region of the Great Central Valley, the reserve is quite special in that it has some of the greatest density of vernal pools anywhere in the Central Valley. And if there's three things that I'd want you to take away from this talk today, it would be that one, vernal pools occur in a diverse array of geologic formations. Two, vernal pools have a high degree of seasonality and distinct phases. And three, vernal pools are hotspots for biodiversity, including plants. For example, vernal pools have unique plant communities and distinct assemblages of invertebrates. And this video here shows a flyover of a vernal pool in spring. And the term vernal refers to spring, meaning that vernal pools are a springtime occurrence in terms of their showy flowering blooms. And as mentioned, vernal pools occur on a diverse array of geologic formations. In the San Joaquin Valley region, which was shown as that red triangle on the map, many of these rainwater-fed vernal pools occur on very old soils that are 2 to 5 million years old and form what is known as Mima Mound topography, which are essentially a series of tightly formed circular mounds that are found in grassland landscapes that have depressional areas between them. And these depressional areas between the mounds seasonally fill with water, thus creating the ephemeral vernal pools. And the Mima mounds are a geologic mystery with over 30 different hypotheses and no clear consensus on what causes them. And in other areas of the state, vernal pools can also occur in very young volcanic substrates in Lassen, Tehama, and Modoc counties, and also on very, very old 10 million year old soils in the Sacramento Valley area. As mentioned, vernal pools also have a high degree of seasonality, and they undergo four distinct phases each year, depending on the season. In winter, during the wetting and aquasis, standing water is present. In spring, in the drying phases, colorful plants and wildflowers abound. And in summer, in the drought phase, conditions are quite dry and vernal pools are often harder to detect on the landscape, especially when the annual plants have dried out and gone dormant. And one thing you can look for when you're looking for dry vernal pools on the landscape is that cracked clay soil, which is shown on the right image there. This slide depicts the artwork of Laura Cunningham, who was with UC Berkeley at the time that she wrote the book, California, A State of Change, which I recommend all of you check out. It's very cool. And the image on the left depicts the various phases of vernal pools and what they would have looked like in the past. And the photos on the right show what vernal pools on the reserve look like in the various seasons. So for example, vernal pools were once very widely distributed throughout California's Central Valley. However, habitat conversion for agriculture and urban development has been responsible for the destruction of what was once a quite large historical extent of vernal pool habitat. And the illustration on the bottom left depicts pronghorn elk that once made their home on the Vernal Pool grasslands. And on the top left, we see some of the migratory birds that'll be also discussed later that continue to make their stop in Vernal Pools, where the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve has long been a stop along the Pacific Flyway, where a ton of birds use the pools to rest along their migratory journey. So Vernal Pools are also considered hotspots for biodiversity, where there's over 20 threatened and endangered species that live in and around California's Vernal Pools. Vernal Pools also provide some very important ecosystem services, including rainwater catchment, runoff filtration, groundwater recharge. They serve as critical wildlife habitat. And again, they're also an important rest stop for migratory birds. And some of the threatened and endangered fauna that are found within California Vernal Pools include fairy shrimp, burrowing owls, and also California tiger salamanders. And more commonly encountered species include an abundance of migratory birds shown on the top left, ground burrowing animals such as the ground squirrels shown on the bottom middle there, and in many grasslands, including the Merced Vernal Pool and Grasslands Reserve, cows are also a common occurrence on the reserve in that they're used as an important conservation tool to maintain native plant biodiversity in Vernal Pools by controlling non-native annual grasses that were introduced to California as livestock forage during European settlement. And as mentioned, Vernal Pool and Grassland areas, including the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve, are home to both extraordinarily rare and also quite common and widespread species, including the ground squirrel and Botta's pocket gopher, both of which play a very important role as keystone species or ecosystem engineers. And ground squirrels and Botta's pocket gophers, as well as other burrowing mammals for that matter, are responsible for creating vast networks of mammal burrows that are then used by other animals, some of which are threatened and endangered, such as the California tiger salamander on the bottom left there, burrowing owls in the middle, and also more common species such as cotton-tailed rabbits for shelter from predators such as raptors flying overhead, as well as shelter from elements such as the hot summer sun during the dry months. And biologists have also interestingly found that many of these species coexist in the mammal burrows right alongside one another, which is interesting. So Vernal Pools also have distinct assemblages of invertebrates, including the often celebrated but also controversial fairy shrimp, which is a small but otherworldly and even weird crustacean that lives in Vernal Pools. And on the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve, we have four species of fairy shrimp and also a tadpole shrimp, all of which are threatened and endangered. And earlier, the Conservancy Fairy Shrimp was mentioned, which is one of the most rare fairy shrimp. The one shown in the image here is a California fairy shrimp. They've got red bug eyes and forked red tails, and they make their home in quite large Vernal Pools. And these interesting creatures have the ability to completely pause their metabolism to survive months or even years when the Vernal Pools have dried up. And during the dry season, these endangered fairy shrimp persist as cysts or eggs. And during the wet season, eggs hatch and the pools flourish with life. So the reserve also has very high floral diversity, which is my favorite thing to discuss as a plant ecologist, especially in the vernal pools where we've now recorded over 200 vernal pool species to date in California, some of which are common among vernal pools and some of which are globally rare, occurring only in the San Joaquin Valley, where the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserves located. And on the reserve, we've recorded over 200 vernal pool and grassland species to date, of which 85 occur in wetlands and water bodies in general, and 35 occur only in and around vernal pools, making them endemic species. And this image shows some of the flora that's typical on the reserve in both vernal pool and grassland habitat, including fiddlenecks on the top left, of which we have six different species, Calusa grass shown in the top middle, which is very sticky and glandular, succulent owl's clover, which is on the top right with the little yellow flowers. It's quite rare, only occurring in the San Joaquin Valley. And then other more common vernal pool species like meadow foam, which is that white flower on the top right, vernal pool monkey flower, that hot pink flower, frying pan poppies, the yellow flower on the bottom right, downingia in the middle bottom is that dark purple flower. They're about the size of my thumbnail, and also different kinds of brodeas shown on the bottom left, some of which occur in vernal pools. And so I just want to mention that sadly, over the past 200 years, the state has experienced a vast and rapid loss of vernal pool habitat as a result of agricultural expansion in the Central Valley, followed by, to a lesser extent, urban development, where estimates suggest that close to 90% or more of vernal pool habitat in the Central Valley and other parts of the state has been lost due to land use conversion. And this is per the California Department of Fish and Wildlife this year. And so it's for this reason that it's more important now than ever before to conserve the last of our remaining intact vernal pool habitats in the state of California. And the map shown here depicts the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve, which is a star location where that blue star represents the entrance to the reserve that's next to the UC Merced campus. So the reserve is special and that it's directly adjacent to a major UC campus that protects special ephemeral ecosystems. And it's also quite unique in that it's a 6,500-acre reserve that represents some of the last remaining intact vernal pool and grassland ecosystems of its kind anywhere in the world, which is impressive given that we've lost over 90% of our vernal pool ecosystems. And so the vernal pool reserves part of a larger growing network of natural reserves with the UC Merced campus and also the larger UC natural reserve system, which is a statewide network of 41 natural reserves throughout the state of California, whose mission is to contribute to the understanding and wise stewardship of the earth and its natural systems by supporting university level teaching, research, and public service. And so that's really what we do on the Merced Vernal Pool Reserve, is we facilitate a connection to the natural world through research, education, and public service. And so with that, I want to thank you for listening and encourage you to check us out. We're online at vernalpools.ucmerced.edu. And we also have a new website coming that's mvpgr.ucmerced.edu. And if you're interested in contacting me or joining our mailing list, please check us out at mvpgr.ucmerced.edu. And with that, thanks again for listening, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Hello, Joy. Thank you so much for that excellent presentation. Our audience has plenty of thoughtful questions, but I'd like to encourage everyone to keep them flowing. They're great. Let's see. So Tema asks, do all vernal pools grow flowers? And are the UC Merced vernal pools open to the public to visit?
That is a great question. Thank you for that question. So yes, to my knowledge, all vernal pools do grow some sort of flowering species. Some of them do have interesting species that don't produce flowers. And then the vernal pool reserve in Merced itself is not open to the general public, but it is open for uses that have a focused purpose related to research, education, or public service. But with that said, I do offer public tours regularly. For example, we have regularly offered tours in spring in the months of February through April. And we post those online.
Oh, great. Yeah. This is just another reason to sign up for that mailing list.
Absolutely.
Let's see. So you mentioned that cows also use the vernal pools despite being an introduced species. How does that balance work? Do they eat the native grass? Are they damaging to these pools in any way?
Such a great question. There has been a lot of research on that, actually. A lot of really seminal research has come out of UC Davis. And then just this last year, we started our own undergraduate research as well on the topic on the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve. And surprisingly enough, we've found that in the absence of some of our native ungulate species, which are those who are hoofed mammals, such as the pronghorn elk or buffalo that used to roam America's prairies and grasslands, we do need some sort of grazing to promote ecosystem health in grasslands. And so the way that cows do that is by grazing down these larger non-native grasses that can be quite tall and robust and really choke out the smaller statured native vernal pool plants on the landscape.
Oh, so interesting. So they're almost filling a niche there.
Indeed.
You mentioned kind of in passing that fairy shrimp were a little controversial. I want to know, what did they do?
Absolutely. That's a great question. So one of the reasons that the Merced Vernal Pool and Grassland Reserve is there is that it serves as conservation lands for the UC Merced campus. So because a lot of fairy shrimp are special status species and that they're threatened and endangered, they are protected by the Endangered Species Act. And also there are environmental laws that require that if wetland ecosystems are impacted, mitigation must occur. And so when the UC Merced campus was built, some vernal pool ecosystems were displaced. And for that reason, it was a very controversial topic at the time among conservationists. But I think we have a very interesting conservation story as the UC Merced campus and how we worked with neighboring landowners to create conservation lands, including the Merced Vernal Pool and Grasslands Reserve, to protect ephemeral wetland ecosystems in perpetuity and the threatened and endangered species therein, including the fairy shrimp.
Oh, fascinating. Let's see, what else do we have? Orle wants to know, how do tiger salamanders and other similar animals survive in the dry season? I imagine for an amphibian, it's not so great to have a dry season at all. What adaptations do they have to survive that?
Great question. Absolutely. So in the winter and spring months, California tiger salamanders are more in their aquatic phase, where they've got these amazing feathery gills when they're in the water. And then as they grow older, they begin to grow appendages or legs, and then they travel onto land and become terrestrial. And it's really important for them to have those nearby mammal burrows that I was talking about, that ground squirrels or Bata's pocket gophers create, because those then become the homes or dens for California tiger salamanders. And they stay in those dens daytime. And really when you'll see them is at night, particularly on rainy nights. That's when you can find California tiger salamanders coming out of their dens and kind of roaming the landscape.
Oh, fascinating. I've heard of the salamander crossing brigades. When there's roads, people dress up with the stop signs and the cones to let them cross the street safely. I've always wanted to do one of those.
Me too.
Joe wants to know what wetland restoration projects are either currently happening or do you have planned?
Jill, that's a great question. We do have some land adjacent to the Vernal Pool Reserve where we hope to have a future outdoor educational pavilion and also later full field station pavilion. And those would be off-grid and demonstrate the green technologies that campus is known for. And with that capital project, we also hope to have some demonstrational vernal pool wetlands that are a restoration project in an area where the land had been kind of graded, and we have the opportunity to bring back some vernal pool habitat.
Excellent. Wow, it's something to look forward to for sure. Thank you so much for speaking with us tonight. Up next, we have Rodd Kelsey and Kristin Sesser.
Can you guys hear me okay? Well, good. All right. Well, hi, everybody. My name is Kristin, and I'm an avian ecologist with Point Blue Conservation Science. Rod, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everybody. Rodd Kelsey from the Nature Conservancy. I direct what we call our Rewilding the Central Valley strategy for the Nature Conservancy, and I'm based in Sacramento. All right.
Well, thanks, everybody, for tuning in tonight. The work we're gonna share is actually a product of many people from Rod and I's organizations, as well as our close partners at Audubon, California. And this work wouldn't have been possible without the support from the SD Bechtel Jr. Foundation, as well as staff from the USDA's Natural Resources Conservation Service, the California Rice Commission, and of course, the many farmers who participated in the programs we're gonna share with you today. Next slide. Okay, so let's start with the Central Valley. This valley was once a vast and complicated mosaic of rivers and gallery forests and floodplains and wetlands and grasslands like we just heard about. And it once hosted tens, if not hundreds of millions of waterfowl, shorebirds, and other wetland-dependent birds. And Rod found this great quote to share. There were apparently so many water birds that in the mid-1800s, the residents of the valley would actually complain about the noise that they created when these huge flocks moved around the valley. All right, next slide. And a major part of the reason that this valley has for thousands and thousands of years been such a gathering place for millions of migratory birds is because the Central Valley is part of the Pacific Flyway, which you can kind of think of as something of a highway in the sky that birds use when they travel between the areas where they breed in the far north and to more southerly places, like even for some birds, even as far south as the tip of South America. And waterfowl, which are ducks and geese, are the most abundant of the migratory wetland birds that flock here in the valley. And this is an image here that shows the relative abundance of northern pintail, which is a common dappling duck here in North America. And every year this bird breeds in the prairies of the Dakotas and along the north slope of the Arctic. And then they migrate south along several different flyways throughout North America to more southerly areas for the winter. And I want you to notice on this image how high the abundances are in that little bright sliver, if you can see it at the end of that arrow. And that is just inland from the West Coast, and that is California Central Valley. Next slide. Okay, and shorebirds are another group that depend on the valley. And these guys have even longer migrations, with some of them going all the way to the tip of South America. And this particular bird here in the picture is a Dunlin. It's a small shorebird that breeds on the north slope of Alaska and travels to and through the Central Valley. And while they do rely on the coast, and you can see how high their abundances are on the coast, many of them also need safe places to find food and here in the Central Valley, where some of them spend the winter and some of them just use the Central Valley as a stopover to refuel and rest when they're journeying further south and on their migration back north. And here again, I want you to notice that sliver of the Central Valley shining bright, and we have a lot of Dunlin here in the Central Valley. Next slide. And so, like we heard, similar to the Vernal Pool story, much has changed in California since that quote that we shared. Because at that time in the mid-1800s, there were nearly 4.5 million acres of seasonal and permanent wetlands in the Central Valley. And since that time, wetland area has declined dramatically, largely by being converted to intensive agriculture. And what's left are less than 200,000 acres of highly managed wetlands, some of which are permanent, but most of them are seasonal, meaning that they are flooded for only part of the year, such as just the winter, maybe just the spring. Next slide. All right. So even with the loss of so many wetlands, the Central Valley still supports a remarkable abundance of migratory birds in the winter, especially including millions of ducks and geese. It's also important for shorebirds. The Central Valley hosts two sites of international importance for shorebirds. And the reason the Central Valley is still so important is that some of the millions of acres of that irrigated agriculture can also provide surrogate wetland habitat when the crops aren't being grown. So that's usually the winter, which just happens to be the time when the birds are there too. And these flooded agricultural lands are a valuable migration stopover habitat and wintering habitat for water birds, especially the 500,000 acres of rice grown mostly here in the Sacramento Valley.
Great, thanks, Kristin. And so what I'm gonna share with you is some of the challenges we're facing and a program that we've designed to address those challenges. So despite the fact that irrigated agriculture still continues to host millions of migratory wetland birds, they're in much less abundance than they used to be. So it maybe was hundreds of millions. Now it's less than 10 million birds total using the valley. Many of those are ducks and waterfowl. But what we do know is that across North America, birds generally are declining rapidly, almost across the board. In a recent study, it was calculated that over the last 50 years, we have almost 3 billion fewer birds in the skies than we did 50 years ago. And shorebirds are among those that are declining the most rapidly. They're declining by up to 40% year by year, or not year by year. Over that 50 years, they've declined by 40%. And so this is what's the problem facing shorebirds, because what's interesting is waterfowl have actually stabilized. They are one of only three families of birds in North America, and including here in California, that have populations that have done well. And part of the reason is we collectively, as a society and as conservation organizations and as public agencies, have invested about $6 billion since the early 1980s in wetland conservation and restoration. But the challenge is that most of these wetlands and the rice lands that Kristin mentioned that are now vitally important for wintering waterfowl and migratory shorebirds are managed in the middle of the winter and often just for waterfowl. But for shorebirds, which are these super long distance migrants, they're the ultra marathoners of the natural world, Some of you may have seen the recent story that a godwit that breeds in Alaska again broke the world record for migration, traveling nonstop 8,300 miles from Alaska to Tasmania in one jump, which is a remarkable feat. And to do that, they need a lot of energy. And the challenge we have here in California is that shorebirds arrive earlier than ducks and geese. Many of them are arriving here in the valley. In fact, I can hear them, you know, every 15 minutes or so right now where I'm standing. They might arrive much earlier, as early as late July, having bred up in the high Arctic. And they're here much later. In fact, their abundance peaks in April and May, as all these birds coming from this South America and Central America are making their way back north. And the management of flooding, as you've heard from us and from the earlier talk, is highly, highly managed in these landscapes now. And the flooding that does get done is really in the middle of the winter. And what these birds need is they need flooding on both ends of that spectrum of their migration in order to survive, get enough fuel to make these journeys. And what they're experiencing, this is from a new study that we collectively did. And the only thing to take away from this is that the dark red is when during the year, there's simply not enough food in the valley for these birds. And this is every year, not just during droughts. They're arriving here, especially in the fall migration period, and not having enough food, which means they are either not going to survive the winter, or they're going to be very depleted by the time they get back to their breeding grounds and probably not succeed in making new babies. So this is the challenge that we've been addressing as a partnership for a long time. And in 2013, the Nature Conservancy began to develop a new program that was built on all the experience and tools that the partnership had been building, and we called it Bird Returns. And the idea here was to develop a private marketplace that would incentivize farmers to deliver habitat where and when these birds needed it most and be really cost effective about it. And to do that, we needed the science to show us, okay, where could we deliver the best habitat and get the most bang for the buck? And we did that with two sources of information. One was, where are all the flooded areas in the valley over time during the season? And that's what you see on the left. This is basically surface water throughout the Central Valley every 2 weeks across the year, calculated from imagery from Landsat satellites, and then modeling how likely it is to have flooded habitat. And on the right is a product of those same models you saw for Dunlin and Pintail, depicting where and when the birds are most abundant or most likely to occur in the valley. This is for one particular bird, the Northern Pintail. And by putting these two things together, we can predict where the habitat is most needed and we can deliver the most bang for the buck. And so then we run private auction marketplaces where we put out a bid to the farmers and say, and now wetland owners, not just farmers, and ask them, how much do we need to pay you to deliver shallow water habitat at just the right times and places? And then we select those bids based on those data to get the best outcomes. And we've been running this for 8 years now. Those farmers go under contracts. And I'm really happy to report that as of last spring, we had done 17 of these auctions over the years and participating with over 200 farms. And so far, we've been able to deliver about 120,000 acres of seasonal habitat at these critical times. And half of that came this year. And this was because of a major investment by the state of California with us and our other partners to invest in mitigating the impacts of drought, which any of those of you who are in the valley, it is a very, very dry place right now. And so these programs are actually delivering a lot, in some cases, all of the habitat that's available for these birds this year. So stay tuned for more of this as these programs expand throughout the valley. And we're seeing the results. So we're watching how the birds are responding. Over the last 8 years, we've done almost 15,000 surveys, counting millions of birds. And indeed, we're seeing 2 to 3 times more birds on our program fields, and especially during the spring and fall at those times that we've targeted where they seem to have the least habitat. So it seems to be working, but we need to keep going and go get bigger. And we're excited about the future of this program. Thank you.
use so much presentation as per usual has keep them coming.
I think, Darian, you have turned into a robot.
True.
It's the curse of the AirPods.
Oh.
That's it. He's out.
Yeah, he's out. He has to go read. This has happened, so you get me instead, which is too bad because Darian is our resident bird enthusiast. But anyway, is the Central Valley also good at attracting kind of rare or like vagrant birds that show up?
A lot of rarities show up, like in many places, coastal California. If you mean sort of rare warblers, all kinds of rare stuff shows up in the valley. Things from Siberia. The Nature Conservancy owns and manages a large farm in the Delta called Staten Island, which is publicly accessible. I encourage people to go out there in the middle of winter and watch hundreds of thousands of birds come into sleep at night. It's spectacular. It's a semblance of what the valley used to be. And that last year we had a common crane, which is an Asian crane species, hanging out with all the local cranes. Hanging out by itself wasn't really hanging around the other guys, but we'll get stuff like that.
Yeah, great. So you mentioned this a little bit at the end of your talk, Rodd, but one of our guests asked, how is climate change impacting the wetlands these migratory birds depend on? And I guess I would follow that up with, like, what's the ratio of like agriculture and drought and climate change? Like, which one affects the migratory wetlands more?
Both. Yeah, this is a very complicated question. The backstory to all of this is that all of the water in California that's available and people use is highly, highly managed. None of this happens without people turning on pumps and moving water around, even the natural wetlands now, as Kristin was alluding to, they're all highly managed wetlands. And in a year like this, so in the rice context, normally in a really wet year, there'd be 450,000 acres of rice in production. And this year, there's half of that. And that's because there wasn't enough water. That same problem has occurred on the natural wetlands. And so they come hand in hand. But we also have a lot of challenges with how we share water amongst the wetlands and the farming. And that's something that we all work on as a partnership, is how we're going to strike a new balance with a warming climate, because the droughts are becoming longer and more persistent.
And then Gina from the audience asks, are farmers that participate in the program having to pump water for maintaining the wetlands? Where is the water coming from? Is this an issue?
You want to answer that, Kristin?
Sure. I would say most of the farmers that we work with, they want to be good stewards of their land. So many of them flood some of their property, some of their rice on their own with their own funds, because they appreciate the wildlife. And then some of these, you know, for some folks, these incentive programs actually help them to be able to maybe flood more than they might have normally. Mm-hmm. Or for some folks, that helps them afford the water in the first place.
Okay, great. And then are there specific types of agricultural practices that are better for maintaining these wetlands than others? And is that part of your work kind of encouraging these practices?
Yeah, well, one thing I'd say is we need to continue pushing to expand just the natural wetland footprint and restore more of that. And we need to make sure that the water they need to provide great habitat is available. That's a real challenge in California. And so it's just an interesting conversation, and the fight over water for cities and agriculture and nature. But there's no doubt that grain crops in particular, rice and sometimes corn, are really important because they provide a lot of food. And in the absence of what was 4 million acres of wetlands and now 10 million acres of agriculture, agriculture, it has to sort of find a way to balance its water use with the natural values it can create. Orchards and vineyards and things like that, which we see more and more of, do not provide this habitat. And they also make it harder to sort of balance water supplies because they need water every year, whereas these other crops actually can be stopped for a year when we have a bad year.
Yeah, great. And then with, you know, it's awesome to see like the success in this bird returns program that you can see more birds. Are there specific birds that are taking, like, are you seeing, does it work? Is it working better for specific species of birds? Are there some species that you're like, oh, please, like, come back. We want to see more of you. Like, how does that look like?
Kristin, you want to go?
Sure. Well, I think we've done a very intentionally targeted it just to shorebirds because they're the ones in the greatest need during those shoulder seasons. And I think it's doing a great job. So I'd say yay. And we even get some rarish birds, shorebirds too.
Shorebirds are a target because they're doing much worse in this community of wetland dependent birds as opposed to waterfowl, but in years like this they all need it.
I should have mentioned, I mean, there are tons of ducks in these shorebird fields because it's the only water around in that time of year, so everything that likes water will be in these fields.
Is it fine that the ducks are there? They're just doing their thing.
Get along. Great. They eat different things.
Okay, good. Right. Okay. Good. Awesome. And then finally, is there anything that people watching who are very invested in the health and survival of these birds, is there anything we can do?
I think for the people of California to sort of recognize, you know, the balance, you know, that we're all having to strike in terms of our water use. I'd say come visit these places, come visit the National Wildlife Refuges and the other wetlands that are publicly accessible, including the Nature Conservancy Staten Island, and see it for yourself and be an advocate for policies and funding and giving support to the people that are doing the work, including the wetland managers, the farmers, and the agencies that are doing a good job.
Great. Thank you so much for coming on and sharing. And thanks so much.
Thank you.
And up next, we have Gray Grouse. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everybody. I am Greg Rouse, and I work at Scripps Oceanography in San Diego. And what's going to happen today is we're going to move offshore from where we've been in Central California and the land, and I'm going to talk to you about some amazing things that can happen in the ocean. And in particular, I'll talk about an ephemeral habitat that can last for decades, and that's when a large marine mammal like a whale sinks to the bottom of the seafloor. So whales can be huge, as many of you know. They can be 23 meters or well over 70 feet long and weigh 40, 50, 60 tons. So they're truly enormous. And when they fall to the seafloor, they bring with them a huge amount of food for creatures living down there. And that can amount to the amount of food that might have gradually drifted down to the seafloor over decades, all arriving suddenly at once. And amazingly, there are actually creatures down there waiting for these events to happen, even though they are scattered distantly over the seafloor. So humans have really only had the chance to study this in the last few decades because of having machines that are able to go down there, such as the famous submersible called Alvin. And it was Alvin, in fact, that discovered the first whale fall in 1987, just off the coast in Southern California. And here you can see a little diagram of what they found. They drew it, and it was clearly a whale skeleton. And it was surrounded by bacterial mats, and it had some clams and some other creatures. And they actually hypothesized that this kind of habitat was also linked to habitats such as hydrothermal vents and methane seeps. And that led to an explosion of research that's continued on until this day. And the lead author on that original accidental discovery of a whale fall was Craig Smith. And Craig then proceeded to sink a series of whales off Southern California. And here you can see a gray whale. These are whales that had died and washed ashore. And this particular whale, he towed out to sea, and here you can see they visited it pretty quickly after it had sunk. And there are sharks and hagfish attacking the flesh, and they're stripping it of hundreds of kilograms every day. And they then visited this over a period of years, and just a year later, the flesh was all gone, and there was just the skeleton. And there are still hagfish hanging around, and you can see this is an old video back before we got into 4K video that we can get today, but still riveting footage that you can find online at Craig's website in Hawaii. And then after a few more years, there was massive amounts of bacteria all over the world for. And what you might not know is that whale skeletons, the bones, are more than 50% of the mass is oil. And this oil slowly leaches out of the bone over a period of years. And that drives a whole ecosystem after the flesh is gone, living off the oil. And the oil can transform, once it soaks into the mud, into another form of nutrition that's hydrogen sulfide, which many of you might know, rotten egg gas. And that actually can be used by various kinds of bacteria as an energy source as well. Finally, the whale skeleton was thought to be depleted, and if it wasn't buried, would then just live on as a reef stage where creatures might perch on top of it. And there was a wonderful review of this written in 2003. So just some paintings that Craig Smith had done about the initial scavenger stage, followed by the stage where all the oil is seeping out of the bones and supporting a diverse community of invertebrate animals and bacteria, with a subsequent stage that's driven more by that hydrogen sulfide, where the oil's been transformed and you've got animals and bacteria living off directly or indirectly from hydrogen sulfide. And then you end up with this reef. Now, the whale falls have been now discovered all around the world, mostly along continental margins. And this is usually where people are active in doing research in the deep sea. They've been found accidentally by trawling, or people have found them by deliberately sinking whales, which I'll get to in a few minutes. And then also there are known whale fall deposits on land that have been fossilized. And this map sort of shows you the distribution. Most of them have been in the eastern Pacific because there's been a lot of research done on this condition here. And I first got into this back into 2003 when colleagues of mine at Monterey Bay Aquarium and Research Institute in Central California. You can see the map here, so we're just south of San Francisco. And there's a wonderful deep canyon there, which is why this research institute was set up. And they were where the purple spot is there one day and happened upon a whale fall, a gray whale that sadly had died and tumbled down into the bottom of the canyon. And that started a whole research program led by Bob Reinhardt. And Bob and his team invited me out to go with them on a series of cruises, and they actually started to sink whales and started to get a bit of a different impression about what was happening to whales in Monterey Canyon compared to what had been found a little bit further south. And here you can see the whale fall that I showed you just then, which they nicknamed Ruby because it was bright red for a reason that I'll get to in a few minutes. And you can see that over a period of just a few years, the whale fall basically disappeared. It just demolished into the mud, And all you could see at the head end there is actually after the end was baleen. The keratin of the grey whale in its jaw was remained, but the vertebrae had either sunk or been completely demolished. So there seemed to be a bit of a paradigm shift going on, and with more research after sinking six different whales, none of these sulfophilic phases were ever found. The whales were being completely destroyed and consumed in less than 7 years. So there seemed to be this kind of different patterns going on in terms of how whales could be ephemeral and last for just a few years, or if they were a bit further offshore, they might last for decades. And the main point to take away was that apart from bacteria, there was this wonderful community of creatures, of animals that were opportunistic, exploiting the whales, and actually also a few amazing creatures that can only be found living at whale falls. I just want to show this video because it really is beautiful, of the most recently accidentally discovered whale fall by NOAA. This was a juvenile grey whale that probably maybe was killed by orcas outside of Monterey Bay, and it settled on the seafloor at nearly 4,000 metres, and it hadn't been sunk for very long. And here you can see this wonderful vista of octopus, rat tails, eel pout fish, just sitting on the whale, which had landed on its back. The red you can see there on the ribs, those feathery structures, are what I'm going to come to at the end of the talk, and are known as this amazing creature called ozodax, the bone-eating worms. And I'm going to finish up, before I get to ozodax, just with my own story of how to sink a whale. And this is a story of a fin whale, a fully grown female fin whale that sadly was washed ashore here in San Diego at Point Loma in 2011. And she had been hit by a ship. A necropsy established that she was towed to Mission Bay. And then we really scrambled with permission from NOAA to sink this whale to find the weight, to figure out how much weight we needed. It's a long story I don't have to really get into you today. We towed it 12 miles out to sea, attached 7 tons of metal, of iron, to her tail, and sank her there where that rosebud pin is. And she lies there still today. We were not able to visit her quickly, as Craig Smith did, so we never saw that initial stage. But about a year later, we were able to visit, and all the flesh was gone. She's lying on her belly. Really the biggest whale fall that's ever been deposited on the seafloor. And this has given us a decade of experience to study this whale. And we've been able to use new technology such as photogrammetry, and we can fly over the whale with the remote operated vehicle and stitch together lots of images to create 3D models of the whale. And our plan is to eventually publish these, along with a survey of all of the amazing creatures that we've found living associated with this, including quite a few new species of deep sea animals. The whale has amazingly, this is the most recent visit, just before COVID hit back in 2020, and the whale skeleton is very largely intact. It has degraded quite a lot in terms of the projections coming off the skeleton, but for the most part, because it is so massive and there's no sediment depositing out there, it really is largely intact. And we've been collecting every time we've visited there and have built a large collection of animals that are sitting in our museum, the Scripps Oceanography Benthic Invertebrate Collection. And we've been naming new species and putting together a story about what goes on there. And I'm just going to finish with one creature that really is amazing. It's not the crab. It's the creature that's making the bone soft enough for the crab to then eat this whale. And that creature is called ozodax, the bone-eating worms. And they give the bones initially this bright red color, like flowers emerging from the bone. And this was a completely new animal that we only named in 2004. And these are specialists on whale bones and fish bones and any kinds of bones, in fact. And they grow into the bones like the roots of a plant. They literally can dissolve it with acid. And the green you can see there in this bone that's been opened up are the roots. Every single one is different. They grow the roots through there. We've done lots of anatomical work. The main story is that The bones are largely occupied by female worms that are mostly an ovary with these roots. They have a large circulatory system. They don't have a gut. The red plumes you see are their blood. It's full of hemoglobin, so they're trying to breathe with these plumes. The gut and the absence of a mouth relate to the roots, which are actually full of bacteria. But these have symbiotic bacteria living in their roots, and those are after the collagen, not the oil, the matrix, the protein matrix that the whale has and makes up its skeleton, are the target of the bacteria that are symbiotically living with the worm and providing it with its nutrition. And we verified this in various ways, especially through my colleague at Occidental College in Los Angeles, Victoria Hoffman, and Shana Goffredi. And the last question you might have is, they're all females. Well, where are the males? These worms have harems of dwarf males that live in their tubes. And that's a whole other story that I could elaborate on. But a female can have 600 males living inside her tube that fertilize her eggs and allow her to make thousands of eggs that need to go out into the plankton and float around until they can find another whale carcass. If you'd like to read more about this story, there's a nice essay by a friend of mine, Jeff Marlowe, in The New Yorker, published a few years ago, called The Whale's Afterlife. And I'll put the link to that in the script. I have some wonderful colleagues that have helped with this all over the years, especially Bob Ryan, hopefully you can see there. And I'll stop there with this marvelous painting by Tanya Young showing the whale fall off San Diego and some of the creatures that live there.
Wow, Greg, is my audio, first of all? Okay, cool.
Yeah, you're good.
Those Osedax worms are almost out of this world, they seem.
Darren, I'll just let that play.
Oh, okay, cool. I didn't know if there was audio.
In the background about what not to do while we take questions.
Oh, is the whale gonna...
it doesn't great. Need a commentary.
Perfect. The Osedax worms, they were so out of this world. They almost gave me an identity crisis. Like, what am I doing? I don't secrete acid or anything like that. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, Osedax is an amazing animal. I've spent many years studying them and I continue to be amazed by them. We've now discovered about 30 species around the world. They only live on bones, as I said, and their reproductive biology, their physiology is absolutely extraordinary. And yet they're actually an annelid worm. They're reasonably closely related to earthworms and their relatives.
Interesting. Do different species live on different... species of animals that produce bones? Or if there's no whales around, what do they feed on? Other animals' bones?
I did some experiments and they are able to use fish bones such as tuna. We found them on seal bones. We put down chicken bone. There are fossilized penguins that have been shown evidence of Osedax. A story I'm sitting on is yet to be published, but I'll be writing it up soon. And they actually appear to be able to go after the teeth of sharks, which means they could be a group that goes back hundreds of millions of years.
Oh, wow. That's fascinating. Let's see. Blair asks, seeing that modern whale falls decompose relatively quickly from the bone eating specialists, are fossil whale falls ever preserved?
Yes, there are quite a few fossil whale falls, and some of them have been preserved with Osedax intact. And you can see the holes where the Osedax made the burrows. The whales that we studied, many of them were buried eventually. So there's this tension between the action of Osedax and the other creatures trying to take away and eat the whale fall as sediment slowly accumulates. So in some cases, they can get their job done and completely turn over the whale fall into the ecosystem. In other cases, sediment might bury the whale and preserve it as a fossil. It's a bit of a race between the consumers and the sediments.
Definitely. James asks, are whale carcasses ever discovered in the Atlantic? I remember on the map you had shown us earlier along the western coast or the Atlantic coast of the of North America, at least there didn't seem to be any whale falls noted.
I don't recall one that's been discovered off the east coast of the US, but they are known in Europe. And there's been one found off the Azores that I remember was discovered. Fossilized ones are well known in a range of places around the world. Mm-hmm. The most recent one that was discovered by accident was off Brazil, actually, the last one I recall.
Wow. Huh. When you're looking at whale falls, are you able to, without knowing where they came from, identify kind of generally where they come from based on the species that make their way to them?
We're still getting some of the Ossidax worms, for instance, are all around the world. One species we first discovered here in California was then found in Japan, and then Antarctica, and then finally in India, in the Indian Ocean. That one, genetically, we know it's the same species. It is able to disperse around the world. Others are very restricted in where they live and really are very regional. In Monterey Bay, we found 18 different species. Some of them also occur in Japan, but some we've only found in California. So there's this, it's a very early days in a sense of research, and so little of the deep sea has been explored. I could do a whole talk about how little we know. And we're just beginning to get a basic understanding of whale falls, and we certainly need to document a lot more of them to really get a handle on your question.
Yeah, but I bet that's what probably makes this field so exciting, is that everything is so new.
I feel very privileged to be able to study this, and pretty much every time we go out, we certainly discover new species.
I'm sure. Let's see. Edlin wants to know, you mentioned that the Ossidax worms are annelids. She wants to know what the known evolutionary history of these worms is.
Yeah, you might have heard of, I mentioned they're close to earthworms, but a more closely related relative are animals, gigantic worms that live at hydrothermal vents, that are hydrothermal vent worms called Riftia and their relatives. And they have bacterial symbionts in their bodies as well. But they're consuming that chemical hydrogen sulfide, a very energy-rich chemical that certain bacteria can break down. And these worms farm that inside their body. So it's a very similar symbiosis to Ossidax. It's just a different bacteria and a different nutrition source, not collagen, but hydrogen sulfide. So those are the most closely related worms to Ossidax. But other relatives include feather duster worms in the ocean and lots of beautiful marine worms that are all segmented and a little bit more distant than earthworms. So there's a huge diversity of segmented worms in the ocean that are probably unfamiliar to most people. But if you look up hydrothermal vents, one of the most iconic organisms are these gigantic white tubes with red plumes coming out, and those are close relatives of Ossidax.
Oh, and yeah, definitely familiar. I can picture one for sure. Do you have a favorite worm? It seems quite the soft spot for these creatures.
Among the Ossidax, my favorite one, I think, is one that doesn't have the plumes, and we actually named it Ossidax Jabba, after Jabba the Hutt from Star Wars universe, and because it looked very much like the body of Jabba the Hutt, but it's going after little bony fragments that are in the mud, buried. So after the whale is broken up and the bones are shards, this is a special Ossidax that goes after those little bony pieces. Really, that was a real mind bender when we found that particular kind of Ossidax.
The bacteria that the Ossidax worms use to dissolve these bones, there's a part of their digestive system. Are those found anywhere else on Earth outside of Ossidax?
They're actually very abundant, free-living bacteria. They're a group called Oceanospirales, and if you remember the deep oil, the deep water horizon oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico some years ago, Oceanospirales were partly responsible for helping to naturally clean up that spill. They break down complex molecules like oil. An amazing group of bacteria that, in this case, are able to be co-opted by Ossidax as symbionts.
Oh, wow. Is there any, application of these bacteria for, environmental benefit purposes? Have we learned how to wield these bacteria for cleaning up oil spills?
Well, I think we realized that human efforts at cleaning up the deep water horizon were often more harmful than good, and that in the end it was natural processes like the ocean spiralis that did much of the work.
I would like to thank them for their service.
Yes.
Let's see. Just as a closing question, can you just, I mean, those whale fall endemic species sound so fascinating, and I'm sure the diversity of these species is so much more than we're able to go to get into in a 5-minute Q&A, but can you tell us just like a quick overview of like what some of the strangest or most interesting whale fall endemic species are?
There's a snail called Ruby Spira that is a specialist on the bones, and it has only been found there. It grows to be about this big, has a beautiful white shell, and it scrapes away at the bone. And when it was first discovered and dissected, they found large amounts of bone fragments in there, and they postulated that it's probably eating the collagen of the whale directly. It didn't have symbiotic bacteria inside it. The other favorite one I have, apart from Ozodax, is another group of worms that we call the hungry scale worms. They're beautifully iridescent. Their name is Painalea polynori, which means hungry scale worms. They were first discovered in the Atlantic on a parcel of fish that had been laid on the seafloor to see what happens to food when it falls down to the seafloor. And then the first one discovered in the Pacific was out at a whale fall here. And we've now discovered a whole series of species recently that we've named after, one after Elvis, because our nickname for them for many years was the Elvis worms, because they were so beautifully shiny, like the sequins on Elvis's late career jumpsuits. And these worms have scales that look like sequins on their backs, and they are marvelously iridescent. We published four species back in 2020, and there's some great YouTube videos about these online if you look up hungry scale worms. And they're only found on meat, on dead whales or dead meat, only one exception at a hydrothermal vent in Mexico.
I know what I'll be doing immediately after this live stream. Okay, thank you so much, Greg, for this presentation and answering some of our questions. I think that wraps up the program.
Hey,
Christina.
Hey.
Thank you so much to our speakers, Joy, Kristin, Rodd, and Greg, for those amazing presentations. I almost didn't want them to end, but the theme is ephemeral ecosystems, so I guess that is what I ultimately signed up for.
Yes. So thank you all for joining us for this program. We are back on November 17th. With a program we have called Aquarium Without Walls, which isn't literal, because if it was, we'd have a real problem. But this program is actually going to be about the biologists, the work of the biologists who work at the Steinhardt Aquarium, which is inside the California Academy of Sciences, in case you're not local. But they are super skilled and trained, and they take their work into the field. From hand-rearing African penguin chicks in Cape Town to transplanting coral babies in Caribbean reefs. And so we don't get to show off that work, obviously, like in the museum. And so we're really, really excited to have three of them here next week to talk about this work, which is really integral to what Steinhardt Aquarium does. So yeah, please join us on November 17th.
As always, subscribe to the California Academy of Sciences on YouTube so you'll be notified that every time the Night School is on session. Recordings of every Night School stay on our YouTube channel. They're not ephemeral, they never go away. So feel free to watch all of our old episodes.
All right. So, thanks again. I think we'll call it a night.
Yeah. Good night.